Thank you so much for inviting me. I'm going to stand over here, make sure I'm not blocking the way. It's a real honour and a privilege to come and visit you and to share our practice. And I've got lots to tell you, actually, because I've been working as an arts manager, effectively, or a head of arts strategy for the last 4 years, but arts manager in mental health since 2002. And then before that, I was an occupational therapist using arts, and then before that, an art and design teacher. It's quite a long journey, and I think today is all about storytelling and the amazing work that's going on in the country and elsewhere as well. So it's in two parts, and the first part is about kind of the general context around arts and mental health, mental well-being and recovery in the UK and elsewhere, and just to give you a context and the impact and the kind of momentum around this work, with some examples. And then the second part is very specifically around arts and culture projects, particularly ones by our trust and associated partners. So I hope there'll be lots of interest and ways that you can adapt some of this work, and lots of references, lots of online resources that you can further look as well. I think my research today to prepare for this is kind of really overwhelmingly, I've realised that there's a strength in the storytelling and sharing and finding commonalities to support mental well-being, social inclusion and recovery. And some of the themes around resilience, co-production, challenging stigma, partnerships and relationships, trust, finding a safe space, opportunities for interdisciplinary work, and arts to combat isolation and alienation. So I think in my practice over these years, there's an awful lot that the arts and culture can do for mental well-being and health and recovery. So I'm going to guide you through, and just to reiterate, so South London and Maudsley, we say SLAM for short because it's such a long title, and it's a really huge trust covering South East London, so it's the boroughs of Southwark, Lambeth, Lewisham and Croydon, as well as some national specialist services. You may have heard of the Maudsley Hospital. I think some of you have connections with the Maudsley Hospital. And also, you may have heard of the Bethlehem Royal Hospital, which is the oldest in the world. And it's, originally, that's where the term Bedlam came from. The Bethlehem Hospital also has a Museum of the Mind in a Bethlehem Gallery, which is really well known, and it's got a new, fantastic building, actually. So our services are for the whole age group, from children and adolescents, CAMs we say, through to older adults, people with mental health problems and dementia, as well as people with addictions, as well as forensic, as well as developmental behavioural disorders, as well as other specialist services like brain injury and other conditions such as that. So about 4 years, or over 4 years ago, there was a real need to develop an art strategy across the trust. I'd previously been the Borough of Southwark's arts manager working with adults. And so our chief executive at the time proposed that we had an art strategy across the whole of the trust. So I worked with colleagues, and in particular, I asked a group of service user consultants, so they were paid to consult and create focus groups with service users to understand the importance of the arts in mental health and well-being. And I also collaborated with our arts therapists and other staff and other community partners. So the idea is that the art strategy, which started in 2013, will ensure that there will be a greater coordination, connectivity and awareness of the range of arts opportunities available through SLAM for all service users, from children and adolescents to adults of all ages, the art strategy will provide a more widespread and integrated knowledge of the breadth and value of arts in mental health and its benefits, well-being, recovery and social inclusion. There will be an increased engagement and participation in both the formal treatment of arts therapies as well as the therapeutic and vocational arts practice facilitated in hospital, community and mainstream art settings. Because there was a sense that there was a lot of fragmentation, there was lots of really good work, but not a joining up. So overall, my role has been around trying to join the dots, being a bit of a broker, in a sense, a conduit, trying to build trusting, positive relationships across the whole sort of ecosystem, really, I suppose, in London and elsewhere, so that we have greater relationships with our arts and culture partners, the museums, the theatres, as well as the service user-led arts organisations, as well as our colleagues internally. And through the consultation that I mentioned, the service user-led consultation, the focus groups, there was 7 themes that came from that, and this resonates, I think, all the way through. So people said that the arts are therapeutic, that creativity is valued, stigma is experienced both in a negative sense, stigma from staff and carers who are not valuing the arts by the service users, but equally that stigma can be challenged through participating in the arts. And also there were issues around access and finance. But importantly, that the arts provided an opportunity for affirmation and recognition. So, for example, exhibiting as an artist has a profound effect, and you'll see some of this coming through. So it was really important to do this co-production of and co-design of the art strategy. And I hope that you can see this thread coming through. And so the 4 goals are building on the infrastructure, developing activators and champions. So, for example, we've had a number of colleagues that have been just incredible champions, really. So psychiatrists, nurses, psychologists, OTs, occupational therapists, who've become very key players in advocating and becoming artists themselves, exhibiting as well. So I think it's very important to find those champions, as well as, of course, through the service users themselves who can, you know, want to be artists. And expanding connectivity and partnerships, i.e. coming here is an example of that, and raising staff awareness. So building up that actually arts have an important part to play in this work. So raising that there's an acknowledgement around what's available. There is a huge wealth of arts that's available for people, really, if you can think about it. So just to reiterate, it's arts across all types of art forms. So whether it's filmmaking, whether it's creative writing, whether it's attending museums and galleries, whether it's exhibiting art as an artist with lived experience, or whether it's dance or music, whether it's formal therapy through arts therapies, through to artists with lived experience actually facilitating groups and running projects as well, and the mainstream cultural offer as well. So in a moment, I'm going to show a couple of films, and I think they say so much, and I hope you enjoy them. But to just give a context, if you get a chance to have a look at this researcher's work, I've worked with her. She's Dr. Olivia Sagan. She's very well published. She's a psychologist, runs a program in a university in England. And I was very fortunate to be a reviewer on this book, Narratives of Art Practice and Mental Wellbeing. So it's a huge research project, really. And so the sort of aspects of it are that artworks. It works on the level of personal communication and catharsis. It works to help build fragmented identities. It works to give people a routine and hands-on activity that evolves, confronts, and surprises. It works to communicate, to unify parts of us, and to bring us together with others, to open our eyes and show us new ways of thinking about the human condition in all its sometimes puzzling forms. We will probably, I think probably the best thing is to show you the film next. So the film Thou Art actually informed Olivia's research, which was published about 2 years ago. And the film that we made together with, so it was user-led, so the art or the filmmaker, the editor, the photographers all had lived experience. So it was a co-production making Thou Art. And we interviewed people with mental health problems who used art, may or may not call themselves artists, but it was about their journey, about their recovery, the barriers, the challenges, and their recovery. And I'll show you half of it, which is about 10 minutes long. We've screened it many different places, which is fantastic. So we've screened it at Tate Modern, at International Conference on Culture, Health and Wellbeing, and I'm very proud of it. So we'll just show you 10 minutes of it.
It's to do with survival, and if something troubles me now, I actually feed it into my art. It's still painful, but it's painful with purpose.
There's stuff going on inside me that I want to be able to express to somebody that I don't feel they get. You know what I mean? They don't understand, they can't appreciate, they can't really get what I'm trying to say. And so my art is something, an avenue for me to express those emotions and feelings that I can't articulate.
The charcoal woman rises from the land. Here in the burning bush is where she stands. Her smouldering head is turned towards the hills. Her body's rooted in the ashen soil. I'm not always painted and written poetry and so on, but as I became more and more depressed, I was doing less and less. And to me, making art, being a creative, is being creative is a really vibrant way of staying connected with life, enjoying life, whether you're expressing joyful things or perhaps more complex, difficult things. Yet here she stands, risen again from the land, in the kingdom of cars and chainsaws. Still
presence. I have been fatigued, low mood, often at times where I'm not able to produce anything. Ongoing mental health problems, I think.
When I feel really dark in inside, you know, really this, I don't know whether you get into that state where blank, there is no future or something. When I feel like that, and I pray or something, the pot comes with the flower. It's like a very dark pot, clay pot, and it's red roses and green leaves. Also, green is a color of hope. And it has, then the whole thing disappears. It's not blank anymore. There is hope. Hope, that is what art does for me.
Art is the proper task of life. It's my primary means of being in the world and making sense of the world.
But the core that kept me safe, that kept me going, was creativity. It's art. Basically, that was the solution for me.
I mean, for a long time, art for me was a bit like keeping a visual journey of what was happening to me. I think sometimes madness may be about when you do get too alone and too in your inner world.
In terms of other barriers, art is the thing that gets me through all the barriers that I actually feel in my life.
Before I didn't know how to create, before I went to college and university, I didn't know how to create, so I was really frustrated. I could scream my head off. But now I can express what I think, what I feel. I know what people have gone through. I've seen exhibitions, I've been to college, I've been to art school, and you know, that has opened me up. That has given me a voice. It was, before I was just a screaming nutshell. You know, now I have cracked the nut and I am gonna blossom.
Also, what university gives you generally is this way of reflecting about the world around you. And obviously, you learn quite a lot of conceptual things, and you know, I think in the long term, you're better able to make something more interesting out of your existence. Lots of the media that you engage with has a similar source, and you kind of realise that you're part of something quite exciting.
You can be really destructive with art, and you can be really angry with things.
I think art college was fantastic because it probably stopped me being put back into the mental health system. I used to be able to climb into skips full of glass, and then I used to take it back to my studio, and a lot of my artwork was made out of broken glass, and I used to smash it, and it was a bit like a witch's cavern. For me, that's quite a magical moment.
I mean, really, ultimately, I want my art to say something. I don't want it just to be a little pretty cottage picture sort of thing, you know, on a wall somewhere. I want people to interact with my art. I want people to see it and feel, you know, something about it, you know what I mean? Emotionally be moved in some way.
I felt that when I was at my worst, I felt that I didn't have a voice, and I was able to say things through my artwork that I wasn't verbally able to say. I could tell people things that I was silenced as a child, but I wasn't. I could still draw.
I'm still in recovery, I'll always be in recovery. I have to work at not getting depressed. Doing art and the creative process is a relief, and it's a meditation, it's a coping strategy.
I went into a therapeutic community, and it was there that one of the nurses bought us all some disposable cameras and took us out for a walk and got us taking photos, and that was my very first experience of that kind of thing, and I just loved it. I found that all my time, all those days when I had just sat with a book open in front of me and not able to concentrate, but with a camera I could just look through the viewfinder, and just for the few seconds that I was looking through the viewfinder, I could concentrate.
What I experienced, not only was that I was able to give form to stuff for which I had no words, but the actual act of making them externalised the stuff and literally got it out of me so that I could then move on. And that was absolutely phenomenal.
The one thing that has always managed to keep me, you know, sane to a degree at least, is that they eventually find out that I've got, you know, a bit of drawing talent or whatever, and they usually give me some paper and pencil, and then I start drawing, and that inevitably helps me to get recovered.
It's much more proactive than trying to do counselling with someone, because then I can get off a broken record. Because when you're just talking about something that's negative all the time, you're also, now it's been discovered, producing the negative chemicals in your brain.
Whereas when you're doing something that's putting the negativity into a positive, you're actually creating more positive chemicals.
It's the last 20 years since I've become really adapted to my illness, which is sometimes horrendous. I mean, sometimes it scares me silly what I say to myself. But sometimes I am so entranced by the beauty of what I create.
For me, the crucial thing is when you make art, there's no conscious language process that you're going through. So you can get emotions out that you're too scared of facing and putting words to. So I also don't have to be too exposing in the stuff that I put out, but I understand what it means to me.
I'm beginning to wonder if the art of the mentally ill is actually more interesting than the art that normal artists, I don't think normal is the right word, but, you know, conventional artists would be.
I'm an artist that happens to have mental health problems. I'm not a mental health artist. I think a lot of people become artists because they have bad mental health. But I also think for other people, other artists, it goes hand in hand. Art reflects how you feel.
Ad sacha, jigat sacha, evi sacha, nanako se pi sacha. Is that random? Enough?
Perfect.
And what does that mean?
Some of it would mean we are all one, there is one truth through all time.
So, Thou Art Film was funded by the Maudsley Charity, the Arts Council England and University of Arts London, UAL, which is the consortium of art colleges across London. And in fact, it's an example really of a catalyst, really, which I find throughout a lot of my work is... So UAL, they have a widening participation department, and in fact... It led on to an interest by the department on recognition of the value of students or people that with lived experience of mental health problems in encouraging them to become students because of how much recognition there was around their art and how that could enrich the university. So we had conversations around how do we support progression and ongoing, really. And in fact, there's a new project that's being piloted at the London College of Communication shortly around how do you find the best way to encourage students with mental health problems to make the most and be supported in the best way at university. So... again, another journey, really, and in fact, a number of those people interviewed, they've co-presented it with me, or they've graduated, or were actually graduates in the first place, and in fact consulted on the art strategy, and so a fascinating process, and as I said, the narratives... as a methodology was then used in Olivia's book, as I mentioned. As we go on, and I put this here because this is an example of a gallery in a mental health service. And it's a way of showing you how you could consider your workplace and a place for showing artwork of marginalised people, in particular people that you know, your service users and other community. So Salome Gallery is named after the curator, Mary Salome, who started it up. She's a carer, a mother of a person who uses the services and an artist. And it was her incentive to make a gallery space in this multi-purpose meeting room The building is in Brixton, in the heart of Lambeth, and it's the service is called SHARP, Social Inclusion Hope and Recovery Project, and I work very closely with them. So it's a SLAM service, and together, steering group, we did an evaluation of the impact of having a gallery in that base. And it's available online. It's called Recovery Through Art at the Salome Gallery. So it's a celebration of the artwork and interviews with the participants, the artists who've shown there. And in fact, the artists have also included some staff members, and there have been some group shows. I've shown work there amongst some psychiatrists and nurses, OTs, alongside artists with mental health problems. So it started in 2011, and it's again a journey of looking at sustainability and development, looking at how do we reach out to the wider community. And I've got an example of how we're doing that in a little while. But just to highlight some of the findings, just for reference and to kind of further reveal the challenges and the opportunities in having a gallery that people can exhibit in. So the headline here: I've been suffering from serious anxiety and depression for many years. When I took up painting, I discovered that this was the best cure for my illness. Now I use colours, not pills, to calm me down. So there were three main areas of findings. The importance of exhibiting, that for any artist exhibiting, especially for the first time, can be a profoundly confronting and exposing experience for those with a history of mental health problems. This can even be more so. But there's an opportunity there for healthy risk-taking. And people found that actually, although it was very scary, they actually were really glad that they did it. The artist valued the inclusive approach of the gallery and the containment of the gallery, and so Mary's nurturing of the artist and encouragement, as well as the other members of the team. They also acknowledged the role of the non-mental health professional or real artist, i.e. Mary, as a curator, significantly to the recognition they felt from exhibiting. And some people have sold their work and sold them to doctors and other people, and for them that was a real sort of amazing thing that actually somebody wanted to buy their work. Some artists who use services we talked to highlighted the resilience and personal agency which exhibiting gave them, their relationship with their artwork changing from a private unrecognized pastime to something more significant. It felt like a natural job. Also highlighted was the fact that showing work and selling it was free, so there was no commission charges. Participants pointed to often significant financial constraints they experience with limited opportunities otherwise to exhibit. Selling work was noted as significant for their development and recovery. And then there's a well-being theme. They described the gallery as being an accessible place, challenging stigma through inclusivity and facilitating integration with different aspects of their lives. So regularly, I think it's every 2 or 3 months, there's a new show, group show or solo show, and there's always artist talk. So always there's an opportunity for those people with lived experience of mental health problems to talk about their artwork. And that community, that kind of sense of revealing what you want to, but in a kind of safe place. So somebody said, when we had artist talks, I just got to talk about my work for ages. That was really nice, because I think creating a world which is inside is quite stressful, can cause a lot of distress. So it's nice to have that as part of this, instead of just ignoring it or having it as something which you can have, which you just have to push aside and get on with everything else. You can kind of like sort of a bit of a community sort of thing. And I'm going to reflect a bit more about that opportunity around talking about your art in a little while as well. Artists who use services also point to the experience of exhibiting helping them to develop stronger resilience to criticism. There were other beneficial elements of the balance of a structure to your life and engagement in the community. So all of that's available, as I said, if you want to look for the book, and obviously the importance of exhibiting art. And to finish with that, from the artist's statements, I have a long history of mental health challenges. I have experienced many things I'm told are not real. Rather than explain what they are, I'm more interested in putting forward the idea of really good use of the imagination. Art making can be a place to create a parallel world where anything like in dreams can happen. I hope you can kind of, there's a lot of writing here to kind of digest, and again I can send it to anyone who wants to look at this. So this was a way of trying to populate the evidence that's published in different forms, so quite there's examples in occupational therapy, journal, Thou Art, film, and other places that I placed in these categories. And the art strategy, I report to our Social Inclusion Recovery Board. So we have a Social Inclusion Recovery Strategy. And they are fostering relationships, promoting well-being, offering treatments and interventions, and improving social inclusion. So for example, we don't need to go through all of them, but it's quite hard for me to read it from there. Social functioning networks, relationships, connecting. Art is a connector with and to things other than oneself. Partnerships, peer support, belonging, being valued, public engagement, enhancing the environment, promoting well-being, that flow, sense of self. I'll give you a moment just to read through for yourselves, really, probably easier. I think, if anything, there's always this constant need to try and evaluate and evidence the arts in health, and I'll talk about that in a moment, but it was one way of trying to understand what goes on through the practice and gathering different references. So just to recap, what is mental well-being? A dynamic state in which the individual is able to develop their potential, work productively and creatively, build strong and positive relationships with others, and contribute to their community. It is enhanced when an individual is able to fulfill their personal and social goals and achieve a sense of purpose in society. And I do think that the arts and being involved in culture allows for this. So, for example, realizing your own potential by, you know, realizing you have a talent or that you can make art, it helps you to cope with normal stresses of life, be productive, fruitful, and make a contribution. And I'm sure a number of you work in mental health, you're very, very aware of the contributing factors to mental ill health. Society, community, family, individual is one way of putting it, but it's a very brief chart, really. And you're probably very aware of the five ways of well-being. Are you? I mean, it's the New Economics Foundation. Connect, be active, take notice, keep learning, give. And I've got a little film here that was made. I mentioned Sharp, that service, and Michelle Magnari, a filmmaker and mental health service user, she put together this lovely film. So we'll do that now. No, it's the other one, actually. Yeah, that's it.
for me means something quite holistic. So it's about taking care of both the body and the mind, and doing activities that promote well-being rather than just focusing on times when you might want to do something to fix an injury or to fix something that's gone wrong.
Sometimes well-being can be mistaken for sort of like happiness and having a feeling of positivity all the time. I mean, I think well-being can be about just accepting where you are at the time and knowing that, you know, things ebb and flow and there will be the ups and downs. And I think that's an important part of well-being, is accepting the fact that feelings will always change and things always change. And, you know, so part of well-being is about being adaptable to things being changing and not being afraid of change.
Well-being is the absence of extremes. It's living within something that's a bit stable. I think my default position is lack of stability. So being stable without too much drama, too much excitement, be it happy excitement or unhappy despair, and that sort of thing, is for me well-being.
My suggestion will be in this respect is the idea of waking up in the morning and knowing how your day, what your day is going to bring and what are you going to contribute in that day. Well-being is about eating well, it's about feeling well, it's about relating to other people in a positive way and finding sense. And many people don't have that possibility of finding meanings in the things that they do, no?
Certainly in the work that I do, which is encouraging people to come together as a group, either to practice Tai Chi or to do some mindfulness meditation, there's something about practicing an activity together that allows you to really feel connected to the people that you're working with. And certainly what I believe is happening is that when you're in a group of people who all have the same intention together, something very special can happen. So they're really all tuning their minds and their brains to the same activity, and that allows a real sense of connection and community.
Connecting with others is an ongoing challenge, simply because I don't have the trust that is required. So it's always a case of building up relationships and nurturing them, and when I'm unwell, it's always a case of me thinking that the worst has happened and that people are rejecting me, or I might reject them before it comes to the point where they reject me. So it's an ongoing challenge.
Music's a really good way of connecting, a way of connecting without kind of words and without meaning in a way. Music means a lot to me, so when I meet someone where music means a lot to them, then I feel like there's a shared understanding, a shared life experience as well, a way of looking at the world.
Being active and keeping the body active is crucial to well-being. You know, the mind and the body are connected, and we can influence the mind by being active in the body, and we can influence the body by doing certain things with the mind. And we know that being active is as effective as antidepressants in helping people to recover from short periods of depression. It's also very helpful for people with chronic health conditions. You know, getting out, being active, releases endorphins, which are the kind of feel-good hormones in the brain. So really any kind of activity can do that, whether it's a walk or a run or just going out with a friend, walking around the block, very important.
We think that physical therapy has such an important role in the well-being of people, because that's associated to nutrition, to relating to people, to connecting, finding out what are the opportunities there, accessing them, and the so-called social inclusion, and it's part of the whole package, you know?
Mindfulness has been really good for me. I'm naturally someone who wants to go at a million miles an hour the whole time, and I've really had to make myself slow down. I think it's been a lot of learning recently that I've realised that actually by going slower, I'll still get the most, you know, most out of life, but I'll really notice things and enjoy things along the way. And through drawing as well, that's really slows me down. I'm able to really explore and look at things, so things that you wouldn't notice been there.
If I'm walking down to Brixton Road, I always look around. It's like there's a little park. I look in the park, I see birds. I always watch the trees, and I see the seasons. So for me, that's taking notice. And I change with the seasons. I'm aware of that. My moods change. The things I do, the things I paint, you know, so I take notice and just be with my surroundings.
Taking notice is taking pleasure out of what people who don't take notice think are mundane things. So I guess it's in some way, even though it sounds a bit cheesy, looking at things afresh and as if they're kind of new and you haven't seen them before, and being kind of curious in that way, rather than assuming that just walking past and being, and yeah, like you say, I mean, like, there must be so many people that just travelling is just a means to an end, it's just a way of getting somewhere rather than enjoying kind of what is out there. Because I mean, really, there's, if you look at the world in that way, then there's just infinite variety of things to look at and to enjoy and to hear, to smell.
Because of the things that I do in groups, and especially like with the Tai Chi, it's taking notice of how you move. First of all, you've got to take notice of what the instructor's doing, because it's more you follow by doing rather than, you know, anything that's sort of prescriptive in that way. You take notice of how you move as well in relation to, you know, the environment around you. And what's really nice is when, you know, we come out here and we train and you take notice of the trees, because you're there and some of the poses that you're doing, like being like a tree, and how your feet feel on the ground. And so that's what Tai Chi does. It helps you take notice, you know, of all sorts of things, your balance and just the way you move, and also the flow of like energy, chi inside you as well. You start to notice that.
I rate learning. I think that's key to a good life, like the pursuit of knowledge. I think it's important. Whether you do that on your own or whether you do that with others, whether you do it with a teacher, I think it's sort of fundamental, really.
I do a lot of courses. I kind of love evening courses. So I do printmaking and jewellery making, and I kind of describe myself as a jack of all trades. I like to do different things, and I enjoy that initial process of developing a new skill. So I think it's something I'll continue to do.
In overall, we live in a very narrow-minded society, isn't it? But focusing in the football group here, obviously the guys, from the moment they are coming here, they are giving and they are receiving. It's a process of give and take, to feel part of the group. Many of these guys have been isolated for such a long time, no? And here are the first step of starting developing network, friendship, finding sense in a meaningless kind of environment, and so on and so on, no?
How I got into occupational therapy was through volunteering. I started teaching adults who had mental health problems arts and crafts and pottery, and then I discovered occupational therapy through that. So that's a more formal way of giving. I think I give my time and I give a lot of energy to things as well, and I'm quite passionate about what I do. So I think giving people my support in what I do, friends and family as well.
I think many of my eBay mistakes, they go back to charity shops. I often think that's my way of, you know, I'm on a low income, but that's when I feel guilty about not giving enough. I think, well, I actually give quite a lot of quality clothes that don't fit me to places. But I also give as a human being, I think, when I'm able to. And I like my relationships to be authentic, and I think that requires giving of yourself.
My main tip for people is to slow down, because it's in the slowing down that we can begin to take notice. It's in the slowing down that we can notice connections that we have with other people, even if it's just with a shopkeeper or a bus driver. When we're slowing down, we're able to learn more because we can just see what's unfolding in front of us. And that might just be pausing, for example, before we automatically answer our mobile phone. Or it might be slowing down as we're walking to the shop so that we can take in the sounds of the birds or the environment around us. Or even just slowing down when we're eating our food so we can appreciate the tastes and the smells and the textures. So slowing down would be my top tip.
One tip to others, I reckon something around, and for myself as well, is for kind of to have self-compassion, to have an openness to yourself and acceptance for yourself as well as trying things and giving things a go, stepping outside your comfort zone and just noticing what's up there. Don't look at the ground, but look up and look at the colours and the trees, and maybe slowing down with that as well. So there's about five tips there, but yeah, they're all quite important.
So a couple of people there I work with closely, Anna, the OT, who steers the art gallery, the Salome Gallery, and Mary, who was painting the wall there. She's the curator I mentioned. So I'm going to show another quick film in a moment as well, just for furthering on from Five Ways of Wellbeing. And I think museums, for example, are using Five Ways of Wellbeing a lot in the UK, certainly. As you can tell, it can probably have lots of ways of applying. So this wheel of wellbeing is an extension, really, of Five Ways of Wellbeing, but it's six categories. And it was created by Tony Coggins and his team at SLAM, the mental health promotion team. And you might like to have a look at the Wheel of Wellbeing website, which is really great resources on there. And it's all about your location, people sharing their tips, their strategies for wellbeing. So the idea is with wellbeing, you have you have the categories of body, mind, spirit, people, place, and planet, looking after our planet. And there's this very quick 2-minute long film just to kind of set the scene, really.
Welcome to the Wheel of Wellbeing. We believe that the way we think and feel is just as important to a long and happy life as good food and physical exercise. Why? Because all over the world, research is showing us that people with higher levels of well-being are more resistant to colds, feel more connected to others, and can even live up to 7 years longer. They recover from surgery more quickly, feel pain less acutely, are more creative, and are better at problem solving. Until recently, scientists believed that well-being was inherited, so if your parents were pessimistic, you probably would be too. Now we know differently. We know that our genes, upbringing, and circumstance only account for 60% of our well-being. The remaining 40% is down to how we choose to spend our time and our general attitude to life. If you'd like to know how well-being can be improved, check out our Wheel of Well-Being. That's WOW for short. It includes six aspects of well-being, all linked with a positive suggestion for action. So for body, the action is be active. For mind, it's keep learning. Spirit's about giving. People's about connecting. Place is about taking notice. And planet challenges us to care. If you're as interested in well-being as we are, whether you're a guy, gal, gran, group, or government, welcome. We hope you'll find this site a great place to explore, learn, and share information about things that help us all think and feel better.
So recently, I was invited to speak at the Heritage Lottery Fund, HLF's, roundtable on mental health, dementia and heritage in Manchester at the Whitworth Gallery, which has a big, really fantastic programme around museums and wellbeing. And I talked briefly about WOW and Five Ways of Wellbeing because as I mentioned, museums are very interested in this, and they actually reference Wheel, and so I reference WOW, and Tony Coggins, as I said, he's gone out to Australia and taking it there to the university, I think Queensland, I can't remember now, but anyway. So lots of resources that you might find really useful on there. So again, on the mental well-being side, so this Art into Life, Mental Wellbeing Impact Assessment, or we call it MWIA, which is still a bit of a mouthful, I undertook this report probably about 6 years ago now. So Art into Life is a Tate Modern program, and they invited us to take our older adult inpatients along to take part in the gallery workshops led by Liz Ellis, who was the learning manager at the time. So we all agreed we wanted to evaluate it, and again, Tony Coggins actually co-created the MWIA with colleagues, and it's also available on Public Health England's website, because there's lots of health impact assessments, and there's quite a growing amount of mental wellbeing impact assessments. And so it's quite a big report, and it's... We basically did a workshop with stakeholders, with patients, staff, to examine the impact of going to the Tate Modern Art into Life program. And the protective factors that you look at are enhancing control, increasing resilience and community assets, facilitating participation and promoting inclusion. And we only did the two, actually, on that day and subsequently. And regarding the protective factor, resilience, community assets, the key agreed determinant was that it was the shared public space. So going to Tate Modern was seen as very important to our stakeholders, because it felt that there was, not only was it prestigious and highly regarded shared public space, it was the freedom of an open space with different kinds of interaction and engagement. Compared with feelings about the ward environment, it was perceived as, which was perceived as less therapeutic, the ward was, people felt safer. Actually, one patient said he felt safer in Tate Modern. And they felt that they could express their views, make connections with life stories and sense of belonging and connection. So it led on, this was really quite a profound thing for us, for my colleagues who I supported in the older adult inpatient ward. It was quite a challenge to go to Tate Modern and begin to take vulnerable older adults there. But we did it, and people felt much stronger about being able to take healthy risks and go on other visits. So it led on to our bigger program called Journeys of Appreciation, or JOAP for short, and which includes more wards with older adult inpatients with mental health problems and dementia, and more museums. And I'm particularly mentioning this one in particular because it shows an example of partnership working, our growing partnership with Tate Modern and Tate Britain, Horniman Museum, which I'll mention in the second part in particular, and Dulwich Picture Gallery, and they all have a real keen interest around well-being and inclusion. And that second picture, the picture of the lady with the bird, that's at Horniman Museum. And we've done all sorts of evaluation on JOAP, and we definitely found that there was that shared learning between staff and patients, and it was really quite important cultural shift for us in that directorate. I will, all of this I can send, if people want to have a look further at the evaluation, I can send that on to you. I'm conscious of time as well. How are we doing for this first part, time-wise? Because I've got a few more slides for this part.
So I think if you show the slides.
And yes.
We have time a little bit for the questions before we break for the...
And then, yeah. So we've got time.
So that we can have a little bit discussion now.
Yes.
And then you will present the next thing, and then we have a discussion.
Okay, fine.
So...
Yeah, we're doing all right then. So And I'm pleased to let you know about Outreach Europe that I was part of, EU-funded cultural project. Our partners were in Denmark, the Outsider Art Museum called Gaia Museum, who were the lead partner, and then a Swedish museum education partner called Elderberry, and myself as the lead in SLAM. And I've brought an example of it here. And there's quite a few Finnish museum examples in the survey, not particularly for asylum seekers, but for other marginalised groups. Basically, Outreach Europe was around surveying good practice in museums, principally across Europe, and how they outreach for with marginalised groups of people. So whether they are asylum seekers, whether they're homeless people, whether they are older adults, sort of marginalised people. So you can. There are some examples of museums in other countries that have worked with asylum seekers. So you can reference that just to see how you can, you know, you might be some interest there. But definitely, I'm very... You know, it's been great to work with a number of our museum partners, and certainly in the UK, there's a real appetite for working together collaboratively. And that booklet is also available, and that was the case study for the overall conference that we had in England, which I wrote, which has got all the sort of references around mental well-being and the story of what we did. So some references here, quite recent ones, to have a look at. The book Creative Arts, Health and Wellbeing, International. Key people in the UK, leaders, academics like Stephen Clift and Paul Kamick, who are at Canterbury Christchurch University. They have a Sydney Dehaene Institute on music and singing research. Amazing results around singing, actually. And so just for reference, you can look up some of their work. And then I said about the Museums for Health and Wellbeing, that report there in the middle, really useful report, recommendations around inclusive work. And it's a very new alliance between museums across the UK. A person called Helen Chatterjee, who's a professor who leads on that. And then this UK's ageing population, JOAP, was included as an example of cross-sector partnership working. And basically, British Museum is leading on an age-friendly museums network. So, it's another reference that you might kind of like to have a look at, really. The Royal Society for Public Health are real champions of the arts and culture and health, and there's this report. It's really great to have their support. And then this What Works Wellbeing, which is a government initiative, and this they're looking at culture and sport, workplace wellbeing and community, I think. And I was an observer in one of their public dialogues. This report here is on culture and sport, and there's some really interesting findings. They asked people to talk about culture and sport and what it means to them. So quite, this, you know, wellbeing is a popular subject. Arts Council England is quite interesting infographic with some findings. You can look at that for future reference as well. Certainly, Arts Council recognise that frequent engagement with art and culture is associated with a higher level of subjective well-being. People who had attended a cultural place or event in the previous 12 months were almost 60% more likely to report good health compared to those who had not. There's all sorts of references there. And then this really, I mean, I hope I'm kind of revealing really how much there's been such a growth around arts and health and arts and mental health in the UK. I've certainly seen it in the last 5 years. It's really achieving big recognition, really, I think, even at parliamentary level, which I'll tell you about in a moment. But AESOP is this arts enterprise with a social purpose, a body that have galvanised a lot of work. And last February, at South Bank, the Royal Festival Hall, they had a showcase and conference. And I was thrilled to be able to co-present JOAP as one of the 24 case examples of good practice in arts and health. So arts and health, i.e. dance with Parkinson's, there's another dance project, which is a slam project working with young people with psychosis called the Alchemy Project. There's the reader organisation Reading Out Aloud. There's South London Gallery Project Creative Families, which has principally a number of asylum seekers in that group, and I'll tell you about that in the second part. So it was a big occasion, and a lot of these, they're again online, the examples, and it's all around how do we take this further, how do we get commissioned, how do we encourage people to think about arts and culture for health conditions. And in fact, there's one project which you might like to look at. It's the Malasha one, this one here. It's a big GP practice in London. They realised they needed to make an educational tool for Muslim people to talk about mental well-being, and so they've made a film. So it's quite interesting how GPs have put that together with people. And I thought I'd put this in here, because recently AESOP and BOP Consulting are trying to work out what are the active ingredients in arts and health. And so they're kind of, it's a process that people are contributing to try and understand the various ingredients, as if it's like medicine, but how do you talk about it? And this isn't the whole list, really. But it's a way of trying to show what's going on to get recognition, really, from policy and funders, policymakers and funders. So social interaction, flow, recognition of a creative identity, curiosity and newness, escapism, alternative modes of expression, encountering the other, sense of accomplishment, making objects and behaviours that are special, actions that symbolise the breaking of taboos, performance pressure and sense of achievement, and some that kind of resonate with what I've talked about earlier. So in a way, we're all trying to pull this together to try and explain what goes on. And I mentioned parliamentary level. There's a Lord Alan Howarth, who's been a champion of the arts and health, and he chairs this all-parliamentary party group, APPG. There are lots of different specialist groups at parliamentary level, and there's one on arts, health and wellbeing. And they have these roundtables in the House of Lords, in committee rooms, and I've spoken about JOAP and at a museums and health roundtable. And they're putting together an inquiry report, which will be available this summer. King's College London are writing the report, and they're looking for different examples. So again, trying to raise the profile and acknowledgement of the work that goes on. And the themes, again, you can have a look at. There was a particular roundtable on post-traumatic stress disorder and focusing on soldiers, war veterans, and discussion of different arts for people who are suffering from PTSD. They've looked at young people and mental health through the arts, all sorts. So, again, another reference. Program of work to try and join the dots has been this cultural commissioning program funded by the Arts Council, and I've taken part in some of the conferences a report as well. And it's about how do you align arts organisations with health commissioners, because there's often a difference of language, of understanding, and how do you kind of find ways to collaborate and to commission and to to build trust really in arts projects for health conditions. So that's a big piece of work, and you know, it's another really good resource if you want to examine, find references. There was a particular conference on mental health that I spoke about Joap again last year. They're all on this website, really. And then just to kind of follow up a bit more around co-production with and not for people. And I collaborate a lot with Guy's and St Thomas's charity, who are a local health charity, a partner with our trust. They fund a lot of arts and health programs, for example, the Alchemy Dance Project, for example, the Creative Families Project at South London Gallery. And it's around the peer support, around building on people's existing capabilities, recognising people as assets, mutuality, reciprocity, facilitating rather than delivering, blurring distinctions. And I think co-production is very important in mental health. And this is another way of looking at it. So again, the assets-based approach, building on existing capabilities, and that ladder of involvement. And this is it's from a mind report for New Economics Foundation. So this is a snapshot really of the partnerships and the art forms and the kind of activities that I am aware of or support, and kind of looking at it's one way of representing the who we work with. So at the top you've got the art therapies, then different kinds of arts in SLAM led by OTs, led by artists with lived experience or commissioned artists. So Flight in the very top corner, that's a particular project, a particular event at Tate Modern with arts organisations, with user-led arts organisations having a day at Tate Modern. Trinity Laban, Music and Dance is a university, effectively. And so it goes around Bethlehem Gallery and Museum of Mind and different festivals. We've had an anxiety arts and mental health festival in London a couple of years ago, and some of the universities and some of the other bodies that I mentioned. It's one way of representing it. And there's many more. There's lots of different examples, really. But just a map of London, southeast London, those boroughs that we cover, and then placing it against the Joap boroughs. You can just about probably see. So you've got Croydon, where the museums are, so Southwark, Lambeth and Lewisham, where the museums are in relation to that. I just thought it was quite interesting to see where we are. And then finally, for this part, is our very exciting Tate Exchange, being an associate. And I'm not sure if you've been to Tate Modern recently, but they've got a brand new extension. And the Level 5 is this open plan, exciting opportunity called Tate Exchange for a number of different associates and other kinds of community participatory arts. And SLAM is an associate, so it's an annual event. And so this, if you're in London on the 31st of March or 1st of April, do come along, because it's a public event and we have creative workshops led by our artists with lived experience. So the artists at Salome Gallery, the artists with SLAM Ad Art, which is a project for people with addictions, Bethlehem Gallery are also giving a talk, and then another associate, Peckham Platform, which is an arts gallery with a social purpose. And arts therapists are also running a Taste of Arts in Therapy. So we're very excited about that. But to just to kind of join it up, I'm very hopeful that we're going to be able to do a research project at that time with colleagues at the Institute of Psychiatry at King's College London, which is our, on our campus, looking at stigma. So, so when we've had artist talks in public events, we've realised that it has a profound effect on, it could have a profound effect on people's identity and their challenge in stigma. So we're actually going to be researching that during that time, and it follows the idea of social contact theory, which is a way of examining prejudice and stigma. So hopefully, all being well, we'll have some really interesting evaluation around the place of being an artist with lived experience and how having contact, having conversations with members of the public could challenge stigma through talking about your art. So that's...
Okay, thank you very much. And oh, this presentation... the presentation and also the taped presentation, the live where Helen is talking, they come to the Paloma web pages because there's so exhaustive numbers of information here. So everybody can go and look more detail and find. I think it takes at least 1 weekend to go this through. But now before we have break, if there's some questions, we could take them and then we have 15 minutes break and then we continue with the art and culture and the asylum seekers and refugees specifically. Mm-hmm. But is there, does somebody wants to, I have a couple of things I which are going in my mind, but is somebody who wants to comment or ask something?
Thank you. Thanks for the fascinating presentation. As a researcher, I'm interested in measurement, a boring subject, but I wonder if you have used some structured stigma scale or empowerment scale or things like that to measure the, the effect of this art activity.
Yes, in fact, with this one here, we're going to use, you may have heard of the Time to Change program in the UK, which is challenging stigma, and it's a big media campaign. And so, very fortunately, the lead evaluator for that, Dr. Claire Henderson, who's an academic at the Institute of Psychiatry, is our researcher on this work. So she's going to use the quantitative questionnaires, as well as we will use qualitative interviews led by another researcher who's from the Service User Research Enterprise, and we will. The idea is that we have both sets of work, and then a report which will go towards the Cultural Institute, the King's Cultural Institute, as a piece of work, and examine and follow people up, really. That's one way of doing it. Another way, I mentioned briefly the Alchemy Project, the dance project. They use the Warwick Edinburgh scale, the wellbeing scale, WEMWEBS, and they had amazing results, actually, from this intensive dance program. So that's been used. I mentioned about the MWIA. That's another way of a kind of a quite a global sense of scale and to kind of how to improve things as well. But I think we're still looking in a sense, and there are other resources for that to guide people on. In fact, ASOP, if you're thinking about looking at ASOP, that resource, there is the University of Winchester, there's a person called Dr. Norman Dakin. She wrote, there's a guideline called Arts and Health Framework, so it can help you in producing an arts project. So there's definitely resources there, but there's no one particular ideal one methodology, it seems.
Well, I have had one thought while you were talking that many of us are practitioners, doctors, psychiatrists, or nurses, terveydenhoitaja, for example, public health nurses who take a little bit care of everything. And I'm thinking that how, because not all of us are art therapists, we cannot refer everybody to art therapist or the group for going to museums. Like you work in the strategy level, but many of us work at the grassroots level.
Yeah.
So how, I think the challenge is that how we incorporate the art on our everyday practice.
Yes, well I think that's where it's co-production, where you, if you can build up a relationship with a museum, a number of the people we work with in the museums, for example, are community engagement officers, for example, or they might have a special interest around health and well-being, and it's really very much about joint working. So you're kind of sharing the practice, interdisciplinary work. So it could be that's with working together with the cultural organisation, as well as other types of participatory artists, and just finding ways to share that practice.
And I think this is something you have to do quite locally, that we in Paloma or THL or Helsinki can say that now every municipality should do this and this, but people have to find the partners in the north, in the east, in their own communities where they work.
Yeah, and it's finding people that you can collaborate with and build the trust. And Liz Ellis at Tate Modern, that partnership goes back to 15 years really. It's kind of building up the relationship and working together, and you know it's about finding the right people to work with. Yeah,
thank you. That's a very good idea. These days the refugees are presented in the media and used often in a very negative way, or I think it would be a very good way for them to become visible in a positive way, to present their arts. That would be good for them and good for our society.
Yes.
I think it would enrich us a lot.
Yes, yes. And in the second part, I talk about the Horniman Museum, for example, and ways of having public open days and exhibiting art and stories. Yeah, exactly.
So now we have time for 15 minutes, so please be back.